Hello friends, welcome to our channel. In this video we are going to learn about the practical, and that is Ketter's pendulum. So first of all, what purpose we are using this practical, or we are actually using this apparatus. So here the Ketter's pendulum is used to calculate the acceleration due to gravity. Yes, everybody know acceleration due to gravity, that is a small g. And its value also known to us, that is 9.8 meter per second or 980 centimeter per second square. So already you know what will be your final answer. Your answer should come around 980 100, because we will use all the parameters in CGS unit, not in MKS unit. That's why or finally we can convert any unit system, MKS or CGS. So final answer should be 9.8 meter per second square. That is what acceleration due to gravity. So acceleration due to gravity can be found by using pendulums, either a simple pendulum or some other pendulum also, and one of them we have to use in this particular practical, and that pendulum is known as Ketter's pendulum. Okay, so guys, you can see the diagram here. In the diagram you will see, or you'll find, one vertical rod is there. This rod, moreover, it is a steel rod, right? And yes, obviously it is a solid rod. So to that rod again we have two masses, m1 and m2, attached at other ends of that particular rod, right? And this I can say it is a center of mass of the rod. That also we have to find where exactly the center of mass, and from that center of mass, whatever may be the distance of this knife edge. Now you can see there are two knife edges at two ends. We have denoted them as k1 and k2. So these are the two knife edges. So distance of first knife edge from the center of mass, we name it as L1, and similarly distance of second knife edge from the center of mass, we will name it as L2. You can see in the formula also, we required L1 and L2, L1 and L2 in the denominator. This is what the final formula we have to use, right? So this is the aim and apparatus. We required Ketter's pendulum, a telescope, stopwatch and the meter scale to measure these distances, right? So obviously this is k1, k2, this is m1 and m2, right? So this m1 is a solid mass, or we can say the solid cylinder, and that cylinder is of material steel. This is also a solid cylinder, m2 also a solid cylinder, but this is of wood. Okay, so on one hand we have a steel cylinder, and on the other hand we have a solid cylinder, yes obviously, but of wooden material. One is of steel material, and yes, k1 k2 are the knife edges. Again we have little bit smaller cylinders as compared to these m1 and m2. One is of wood and other is also of steel. Okay, so these all are movable. That means K1, K2, as well as this M1, M2, as well as these two wood and steel small cylinder also, all are movable. We have screw to all these things, right? We have a screw attached, a screw here, so that we can make loose that screw and we can move all these what we can say different parameters on this rod. Okay, so yes, obviously we are going to see the Ketter's pendulum physically, but just for discussing the theoretical aspect, I have drawn this diagram. Maybe you will get a very clear picture when we are actually doing the practical. So just remember, we have three parameters on other side of the center of mass. We can write it as CM, or center of gravity, and three parameters or three tools on the other side of the center of mass. Okay, so these knife edges about which we have to actually attach the Ketter's pendulum, and about which we have to take the oscillations, right? So this is what the theoretical thing we required when we are dealing with this Ketter's pendulum. Now comes to our formula. So formula, it is 8 pi square divided by g, t1 square plus t2 square divided by l1 plus l2 plus t1 square minus t2 square divided by l1 minus l2. So just I told you, what is this l1 and l2? L1 and l2 are the distances of knife edges. L1 and L2 are the distances of knife edges from the center of mass. L1 and L2 are the distances of knife edges, corresponding knife edges from the center of mass, right? And obviously if we add the L1 and L2, so that will be the distance between two knife edges. So T1 is the time period about first knife edge, and T2 will be the time period about the second knife edge, and G is what we have to find, that is acceleration due to gravity. So now you can see L1 and L2 we can measure easily on the Ketter's pendulum. G, that's what we have to find. 8 and pi are the constant. So what actually we have to get from the this practical is T1 and T2, and T1 is what time period about one of the knife edge K1, and T2 is in, that means in the other case we have to reverse the Ketter's pendulum and take the oscillations about this K2, and that whatever may be the time period you will get about K2, that will be the T2. Okay, so how to do this, that is what we call the procedure. So in the procedure we have to first of all check whether this Ketter's pendulum is calibrated well or not. So to check that, what we will do, first of all 20-20 oscillations about both the knife edges, that means about K1 and about K2, right, so that you can achieve the center of mass. So once you do, you have attached this Ketter's pendulum on the knife edge K1, let us take the set it into the oscillations and count the time, start the stopwatch, count the time, and moreover yes, time required for the 20 oscillations. That means you have to count the 20 oscillations. We consider in one of the reference point, where you can consider from mean point as well as from the extreme point also. So by considering that, just count the 20 oscillations as you have done for the cantilever also, you know how to count the oscillations, and as we have done in case of our torsional pendulum also. There in torsional pendulum we have used the Lampand scale arrangement, but here the oscillations are vertical, that's why we can measure easily with our naked eyes also, we don't require telescope also, right. Now once you measured the 20 oscillations or the time required for 20 oscillations about K1, then make it reverse. Make this simple Ketter's pendulum reverse and attach on the knife edge K2. Again follow the same procedure, set it into the oscillation mode and count the time required for the 20 oscillations. Let us take 2 or 3 trials of each knife edge, and if both the time periods are exactly same for 20 oscillation, if both the time periods are exactly same, then only we can say the Ketter's pendulum is well calibrated. If we got some mismatch, then we have to just adjust these wooden or these steel, these two we will first of all make fix, M1 and M2, but these two smaller cylinders we have to adjust, and again we have to follow the same procedure. This is what we can say the trial and error method, till you will get the time period for 20 oscillations about both the knife edges are exactly same. We have to do this first of all, that is what we can say the calibration of our Ketter's pendulum. Okay, now once you got that both the time periods about K1 and K2 are exactly same, then you can move forward, and then we have to do the same procedure, or we have to take the oscillations, moreover 100 oscillations we have to find time period with respect to 100 oscillations, right. Again we will take 2 or 3 trials for more accuracy, and we will take the average of that. So mean time required for that particular 100 oscillations about K1 and about K2 also. That is what I am saying, let me show you. Okay, so yes, the distance of first knife edge from the center of gravity, that is L1, that is what I said earlier also, that is L1 and this one is L2. So this is what first for the calibration purpose, this first observation table, time period for 20 oscillations, so T1, T2, T3, and we will take the mean. Again time period for 20 oscillations but about what? K2, about K2. So that's what we have to find, and these two means must be same, this value and this value must be same, time required for that. And once you got these two values are same, if we call it as A1 and A2, if A1 and A2 are exactly same, then we can move forward, we can say the Ketter's pendulum is well calibrated. Calibrated, that means we can move forward, we can use this Ketter's pendulum to determine the value of acceleration due to gravity. Okay, and then what we have to do, we have to move to the second observation table, and which is like this, that means we have to find the time required for the 20 oscillation, not 20 but 100 oscillations, time corresponding to 100 oscillations. So time for 100 oscillations about K1. Again, we will take the three trials, first, second, third. We will take the mean of that. We know that mean time is not actually the time period. So, to divide or to get the time period, we have to divide it by 100 because we are taking 100 oscillations. So, about K1, take the time period or take the three trials, take it mean and divide by 100, get the time period T1. Similarly, about K2, take the three trials, take it mean and divide it by 100 and get the time period T2. So, once you got T1, T2, L1, L2 are already known to us. Let us substitute that all values in the formula. This formula G is equal to, or not exactly G, first of all 8 pi square divided by G. First of all, substitute all these four values, get this particular right hand side and then move this G to other side, and the whatever may be the number we will get, we will take it to the denominator of 8 pi square and you can easily get the value of G. So, obviously, we know value of G, it is in meter per second square, but since these distances we will measure by our meter scale, so maybe it will in centimeter, 30 centimeter, 40 centimeter, and yes, therefore the final answer we will get in terms of the CGS unit, that is centimeter per second square. Okay, so let us move towards the experimental part. We will see actually what happened and how to take these readings. So, this is what exactly the theoretical aspect. Maybe some things are not get clear to you as per the diagram and all, but this is just an introduction. Now, we will move towards the experimental part. Okay. Now, friends, come to the experimental part of this particular practical, right? So, what you have seen or you can see in my hand is what the Ketterer's pendulum. As you have seen in the diagram, we have two masses. One is of wood and other is of steel. So, these two are the M1 and M2 we have fixed at the other end of this particular rod. So, this is a steel rod, solid rod, and this is what we can say M1 and M2, you can see to anyone, right? So, we can remember likewise steel one is M1 and below that we have a knife edge here, so that we will call it as K1. So, the knife edge which is close to our steel cylinder, that we will call it as K1, right? This is what our assumption. And again, we have one wooden here in between which is fixed, which have also a screw. We can move this wooden cylinder, small cylinder, to adjust the center of gravity and all, right? Again, to the other side, we have again one more small steel cylinder which also we can adjust as per our requirement to get or to calibrate this Ketterer's pendulum, and one bigger wooden cylinder, and below that we have a knife edge, we call it as K2. So, remember the knife edge which is close to the wooden cylinder, we call it as K2, right? So, yes, you can see I already told you in the chart session, six tools will be on the rod, 1, 2, 3, again 1, 2, 3. So, 3 plus 3, 6 tools are there on the Ketterer's pendulum, and including rod we can say the 7 things, right? So, this is our K2, and reversely we have the K1, this is K1. So, what I said initially, you have to check whether this Ketterer's pendulum is well calibrated or not. So, to check that, what we have to do, we have to fix this Ketterer's pendulum about this knife edge K1 and measure the time required for 20 oscillations. Similarly, we have to do for K2 also. If both the time periods or both the times required are exactly same, then we can say the time or what we can say the pendulum is well calibrated and we can go we can move forward for the experiment. So, how to attach this for the oscillation purpose? See here, we have made a V shape notch here. We have to adjust this knife edge, or we have to fix this knife edge in that V shape notch. Okay. And once it got fixed there, we can start the oscillations. Or I will make it little bit reverse. Check properly whether it is fixed in the V shape or not. Now you can check it. If it is oscillating without getting distracted or without getting fluctuated, then we can say yes, it is well attached or well set for the oscillations. Now you can see this oscillations are going on. So, such oscillations we have to measure. Now, I will consider this point will be the reference point and I will keep the stopwatch in my hand, right? So, as soon as I will start the counting, we should start the stopwatch also. and so that we have to measure the Fenty oscillations. So let me start for us example 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20. So we should stop the stopwatch. Now see here, whatever we have seen in the chart session also, there was also the 34, but here we got some 36. So that also I said depends upon the individual. So likewise, we have to take the oscillations. So oscillation means we know it, this is the extreme point, it will go to the mean position, and then so when 0 it goes to other position and comes to the same position, that will be the 1. So likewise, you have to take the time required for 20 oscillations, and moreover we will take the 3 trials, and this is about K1, right? Similarly, let us stop it after taking 3 trials, make it reverse. Make it reverse means we have to take the oscillations about now K2. This is the K2, right? So again attach it about K2, again see properly whether it is fixed in the V-shaped notch or not, and set it into the oscillations. Yes, it is also taking oscillations about the K2. Again start 0, it will go to that position, 1, then 2. Likewise, we will measure 20 oscillations about K2, and similarly we will take the 3 trials. Now once you got these 3 trials about K2, just compare the values of K1 and K2 for 20 oscillations. If both the values are exactly same, then we can say this is a well calibrated Ketter's pendulum. And if you found some difference between them, then we have to adjust these 2 cylinders, either this or this. This is the trial and error method. Adjust this, again go to the same procedure, follow the same procedure, get the time required for 20 oscillations, and if both the time periods are same, then it is well calibrated. If not, then again adjust these things and do them. That is what we call the trial and error method to set or to calibrate the Ketter's pendulum. And once we got this, then we'll fix the, all these 4-6 parameters, and then we can move to the 100 oscillations. Similarly, now for the 100 oscillations, now this is about K2. So take the oscillations of K2 first, no worries about K2. How many oscillations we have to count now? 100 oscillations means time required for 100 oscillations. So set it with little bit larger amplitude, no worries, and count the 100 oscillations. Note down the time required for 100 oscillations. Similarly, take again 2 trials, that means total 3 trials, and take it mean, and after dividing it by 100, we will get the time period T2. Again, we have to reverse it, attach it about the K1, and follow the same procedure and get the time period of Ketter's pendulum about K1. So that will be the T1. Once you got T1 and T2, let's move towards the calculation part. But before that, yes, we have to find L1 and L2. So to find the L1 and L2, this is Ketter's pendulum, we have to just see where is the center of mass. So to get the center of mass, we have to fix this Ketter's pendulum on a thin knife edge, right? Keep this knife edge somewhere and let us adjust it so that it will get balanced on this. Once it got balanced on this, we can say that will be the center of mass. This procedure, we know that we will just balance it on some point, and that point will be the center of mass. And note down or just make a mark on that particular point, center of gravity, and count the distance of this knife edge from that center of mass. So we know this is wooden, that is K2. So that distance will be L2. Similarly, if this is the center of mass, then measure this distance or distance between knife edge and center of gravity, that will be the L1. This is our K1. So likewise, you will have to get the K1, K2 and L1, L2 and T1, T2. Once you got these 4 values, then all things are about the calculation, right? So let us move towards the calculation part. Thank you. Now friends, come to the experimental part of this particular practical, right? So what you have seen, or you can see in my hand, is what the Ketter's pendulum. As you have seen in the diagram, we have two masses, one is of wood and other is of steel. So these two are the M1 and M2. We have fixed at the other end of this particular rod. So this is a steel rod, solid rod, and this is what we can say M1 and M2. You can see to anyone, right? So we can remember likewise, steel one is M1, and below that we have a knife edge here, so that we will call it as K1. So the knife edge which is close to our steel cylinder, that we will call it as K1, right? This is what our assumption. And again we have one wooden here in between which is fixed, which have also a screw. We can move this wooden cylinder, small cylinder, to adjust the center of gravity and all, right? Again to the other side we have again one more small steel cylinder which also we can adjust as per our requirement to get or to calibrate this Ketter's pendulum, and one bigger wooden cylinder, and below that we have a knife edge, we call it as K2. So remember, the knife edge which is close to the wooden cylinder, we call it as K2, right? So yes, you can see I already told you in the chart session, 6 tools will be on the rod, 1, 2, 3, again 1, 2, 3. So 3 plus 3, 6 tools are there on the Ketter's pendulum, and including rod we can say the 7 things, right? So this is our K2, and reversely we have the K1. This is K1. So what I said initially, you have to check whether this Ketter's pendulum is well calibrated or not. So to check that, what we have to do, we have to fix this Ketter's pendulum about this knife edge K1 and measure the time required for 20 oscillations. Similarly, we have to do for K2 also. If both the time periods or both the times required are exactly same, then we can say the time, or what we can say, the pendulum is well calibrated, and we can go we can move forward for the experiment. So how to attach this for the oscillation purpose? See, here we have made a V shape notch here. We have to adjust this knife edge, or we have to fix this knife edge in that V shape notch, okay? And once it got fixed there, we can start the oscillations. Or I will make it little bit reverse. Check properly whether it is fixed in the V shape or not. Now you can check it. If it is oscillating without getting distracted or without getting fluctuated, then we can say yes, it is well attached or well set for the oscillations. Now you can see this oscillations are going on. So such oscillations we have to measure. Now I will consider this point will be the reference point, and I will keep the stopwatch in my hand, right? So as soon as I will start the counting, we should start the stopwatch also, and so that we have to measure the 20 oscillations. So let me start for us example, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20. So we should stop the stopwatch. Now see here, whatever we have seen in the chart session also, there was also the 34, but here we got some 36. So that also I said depends upon the individual. So likewise, we have to take the oscillations. So oscillation means we know this is the extreme point, it will go to the mean position, and then so what, 0, it goes to other position and comes to the same position, that will be the 1. So likewise, you have to take the time required for 20 oscillations, and moreover we will take the 3 trials, and this is about K1, right? Similarly, let us stop it after taking 3 trials, make it reverse. Make it reverse means we have to take the oscillations about now K2. This is the K2, right? So again attach it about K2, again see properly whether it is fixed in the V-shaped notch or not, and set it into the oscillations. Yes, it is also taking oscillations about the K2. Again start 0, it will go to that position, 1,
Then 2, likewise we will measure 20 oscillations about K2, and similarly we will take the 3 trials. Now once you got these 3 trials about K2, just compare the values of K1 and K2 for 20 oscillations. If both the values are exactly same, then we can say this is a well calibrated Ketter's pendulum. And if you found some difference between them, then we have to adjust these 2 cylinders, either this or this. This is a trial and error method. Adjust this, again go to the same procedure, follow the same procedure, get the time required for 20 oscillations, and if both the time periods are same, then it is well calibrated. If not, then again adjust these things and do that. That is what we call the trial and error method to set or to calibrate the Ketter's pendulum. And once we got this, then we will fix all these 4-6 parameters, and then we can move through the 100 oscillations. Similarly, now for the 100 oscillations, now this is about K2. So take the oscillations of K2 first, no worries about K2. How many oscillations we have to count now? 100 oscillations, means time required for 100 oscillations. So set it with little bit larger amplitude, no worries, and count the 100 oscillations. Note down the time required for 100 oscillations. Similarly, take again 2 trials, that means total 3 trials, and take it mean, and after dividing it by 100, we will get the time period T2. Again, we have to reverse it, attach it about the K1, and follow the same procedure and get the time period of Ketter's pendulum about K1. So that will be the T1. Once you got T1 and T2, let's move towards the calculation part. But before that, yes, we have to find L1 and L2. So to find the L1 and L2, this is Ketter's pendulum, we have to just see where is the center of mass. So to get the center of mass, we have to fix this Ketter's pendulum on a thin knife edge, right? Keep this knife edge somewhere and let us adjust it so that it will get balanced on this. Once it got balanced on this, we can say that will be the center of mass. This procedure, we know that we will just balance it on some point, and that point will be the center of mass. And note down or just make a mark on that particular point, center of gravity, and count the distance of this knife edge from that center of mass. So we know this is wooden, that is K2. So that distance will be L2. Similarly, if this is the center of mass, then measure this distance or distance between knife edge and center of gravity, that will be the L1. This is our K1. So likewise, you will have to get the K1, K2 and L1, L2 and T1, T2. Once you got these 4 values, then all things are about the calculation, right? So let us move towards the calculation part. Thank you. Now come to the calculation part. Here, as I said, we have to consider the center of gravity and measure the distance of first knife edge from the center of gravity and name it as L1. Similarly, measure the distance of second knife edge from the gravity, center of gravity, and that will be the L2. So we got here is 45 L1 and 32 centimeter L2, right? Now similarly, for the calibration purpose we have to do for the 20 oscillations first of all, about K1 and K2, and the pendulum is well calibrated, and we found that all the readings are exactly same, means 34 seconds are required about K1 as well as about K2 to take the 20 oscillations. That means it is a good Ketter's pendulum, we can move forward. And then if we go to the second part of our second observation table, then for what purpose we have to use it? We have to take the 100 oscillations, not only about K1 but similarly about the K2. So again, if we take the 3 trials, so we got here is our first trial is also or all first, second and third 3 trials are only 173 seconds. That means mean of this will be 173 second, and the time period is what we know, divided by 100. We have to divide this 173 by 100, so it will be 1.73 second. Similarly, if we reverse the Ketter's pendulum and hang it on the K2 and again get the 3 trials, so in the 3 trials About the K2, we got 175 175, and last trial we got 174. So average will be 174.6 second, and if we divide it by 100, then it will be 1.746 second. So this will be your T2 and this will be your T1. So we got T1, T2, and here it is L1 and L2. So all four values we got. Let us substitute all the values in the formula and see what we will get. So this is what the formula we know: 8 pi square divided by g T1 square plus T2 square divided by L1 plus L2 plus T2 square minus T1 square, or T1 minus T2, you can take whichever is the higher, and L1 minus L2. Okay. Now, if we substitute all the values here and calculate it, then what we will get is 8 pi square is equal to 8.204 into 10 raised to minus 2 something. Okay. Now, what we want, this g, but actually it is in denominator. So, let us take this to that side and this to this side. Therefore, g is equal to 8 pi square divided by 8.204 into 10 raised to minus 2. Now, do this ratio also, and after doing that, we will found that here the value of g will be 9.64 into 10 raised to 2, but 10 raised to 2 means we know it is 100. So, we will get 964, right? Or we can convert this here only. So, it will be 964. Now, it is in centimeter, because L1, L2 we have taken in centimeter. So, centimeter second square. 964 centimeter second square. We know that the standard value is 980 centimeter per second square, g value, or 9.8 meter per second square. So you might got the question, sir, but our answer comes 964. Yes, some air drag procedure and all, or some air drag resistance is there, that we have actually ignored, because we are performing this experiment. We have performed this experiment in the air medium, and when you are performing in the air medium, obviously not only the air drag, but some dust particles are there, and therefore we may get some what we can say, the difference between those two answers. One is the standard one, and the one we got from our experimental results. So don't worry, whatever you got, that you have to write, and that will be the your answer with some ambiguations. Maybe some other person will do the same experiment with the same apparatus, may get some other answer. Okay, so don't worry about that. Get the point, get the clarification, and how to do the performance, or how to do the experiment, and how to get the acceleration due to gravity. So this is all about the Ketter's pendulum experiment. I hope you got the things, and if you have any doubt, you can post in the comment box. And if you feel this is a value addition to your knowledge, moreover in a practical aspect, then like this video. For more such videos, subscribe to our channel. And yes, don't forget to press the bell icon so that you will get the notifications of our next videos, right? So yes, friends, we'll meet in the next video with a new practical or new some other concept of physics. Till then, take care, keep watching, and keep learning. Thank you. Thank you so much for watching.